We all would prefer to only find critical vulnerabilities when all you have to do is open a URL and a command executes. 5 digits payout, please. But the truth is that we will keep finding bugs with some prerequisites that downgrade them to medium or even low risk. I admit that I am sometimes tempted to not report a low-risk vulnerability, but then I realize that even $100 or $200 for maybe an hour of writing a report is still just too good to just throw away. In today's video, I will show you a few simple rules that I follow when reporting lows and mediums to get the maximum payout. We'll use the example of my recent $2,000 report in Stripe. Enjoy! The first thing that I recommend you is to work with the program, not against the program. I know that you report vulnerabilities to make bounty, and so do I. This is my main goal. But when writing the report, literally imagine the customer of the company you are reporting to, how they can get harmed, and write this in the report. Don't write the report about a hypothetical user, but write about the very user of this company and what can happen with them. With that said, you should be working with the team, but you should not expect the team to work with you. You should expect that the triager will not make any work more than necessary to process your report. Assume they won't fix your minimal errors in your proof of concept or in your explanation. Sometimes, of course, they do, but often they don't have too much time to process your report, so they will do it as quickly as possible. So don't assume they will like cooperate with you, but assume that you have to do all the work yourself. And sometimes that will not be the case, and then you will be positively surprised. The second thing is to not treat the triagers or the team as idiots, and don't try to trick them into triaging your report with higher severity than it actually deserves. Because if you set too high severity, they will just first treat you as someone that's not so serious or not competent, and they might downgrade the risk of your report even lower than it actually should be. If your vulnerability has some limitations, let's say an unlikely user interactions where, for example, the user has to click 3 times, acknowledge this in the report. Imagine what would you say if you were the triager and you would try to downgrade your own report. Think about all the arguments that you could use and try to address them while writing the report, because if you don't do this, what will happen is the triager will think about it anyway at some point. The triager will reply to you asking for these things, and then you have to address them anyway. And you are in much better position if you address them straight away. This gives the triager the information that you are aware of those limitations, but you reported the bug anyway, and probably the triager won't get back to you with your own arguments. Instead, the triager is more forced to ask the team if they want to triage the vulnerability which has lower risk level because of these prerequisites. Of course, this won't magically help you with too many prerequisites. For example, if a program doesn't accept XSSs without CSP bypasses, if you address this in your report, they won't magically triage your bug just because of that. But also, if you don't put this in your report, neither they will accept the report, so you pretty much can't lose on this. Hoping that someone will not notice those prerequisites, I think is just naive. I'm definitely guilty of writing a lazy report when I know the bug is not worth much, but it's still too much for me to just throw away if I already found the bug and all I have to do is report it. This often bites back, because when I write a lazy report, as I called it, it comes back to me with needs more info, with some questions or with whatever, and I end up wasting more time and much more emotions, unnecessary emotions, than I would if I would just sit, spend more time initially on really good report, and the bug would be processed without going back and forth. That's also the reason why I am leaning more towards better paying programs, where of course I will find less bugs and write less reports, but they are worth more because the minimum payout of, for example, $500 really makes it worth the time. What do I mean by a good report? I mean a report where you show the reproduction steps from the ground, from the level zero, because you have to be aware that the triager probably will not know the application as well as you do. The company to which you report the bug, of course, they will know it better than you. But the triager may work on multiple programs at the same time, and the triager just won't know every single application in and out. So try to reset your knowledge and start with the very simple steps like installation of tools, setting up the environment, creating an account, and go from there. It's also a good practice to simply test your vulnerability one more time when creating a report, because sometimes you will then find out that you made some mistake and maybe you don't want to report this bug anyway. It's also worth to attach any code that will help the triager or the program to reproduce the issue. For example, a Python proof of concept, if that's something more complex. If you don't know how to write code in Python, in BBRE Premium, there is a whole series of articles about using Python for security, for reproducing issues, working with HTTP, headless browser, and so on and so forth. If that's a client-side issue that you're reporting, probably you want to create some HTML, maybe just send an HTML, but also a nice tool that I've used a few times is Code Sandbox, where you like host the web app on the platform and also record demos. For simple demos where it's only a GIF, I use Lyscap because it's very quick, and for more complex vulnerabilities, I sometimes just use OBS, Open Broadcaster Software, and I can even record a voiceover if that's necessary. Hi team, I decided to record a demo because there are a lot of moving parts. So first here on the left hand side, I have my DNS server that will return to... Since I finished my challenge of 100 hours on Stripe, I regularly still check new features every month when I receive the newsletter from them. And a few months ago, they added something called Stripe Apps, which is like an extension of Stripe. The way it works is it works in an iframe. And for example, you can quickly export some files into a Google Drive or into Dropbox. At the moment, it's still in beta version, and it's not yet possible to publish my own app for other users. I think at the moment, Stripe still has to approve manually every single application. However, it's clear from the documentation that in the future, users will be able to create and share apps to the marketplace. My report affected apps, and the attack scenario included creating a malicious app. And I mentioned this fact in the report that at the moment it's not even possible to publish my app to other users, but this subject wasn't even touched upon in any message apart from the initial one from me. And the truth is that an immature program in this moment could say, "This bug not affect users, needs more info." But here it wasn't the case. I think most mature programs like Stripe are happy that we report bugs in alpha and beta versions because, for one, they don't have to investigate if the bug was exploited in the wild or it wasn't, because it's not published for users, but it's clear it will be. And the way it functions is that it's an iframe, the app is an iframe, but it's a sandbox and it's well separated from the parent side. My initial attack vector that I wanted to try was to exfiltrate some unauthorized data by a malicious Stripe app, but I was not successful with this. But then I stepped back a little bit and I noticed that if I put a login and password fields in my application, LastPass or other password managers can autofill my credentials into the app. Then a malicious app could send these plaintext credentials to the app's server and log in as the victim, giving an account takeover. But the truth is that this bug is more fault of password managers, because from the browser's perspective, the iframe separation between Stripe normal page and Stripe app was as good as it can be. Then why didn't I report this bug to password managers and instead to Stripe? The truth is, I did report this bug to one of the password managers a few months ago, and it was marked as duplicate of a won't fix bug from an internal assessment from a few years ago. They said that they accept the risk of that, and I kinda assumed that other password managers also know about this. And I didn't try to hide this fact in my report, hoping that Stripe or the triager will not notice this. I made it very clear in the report that I think it's more of a fault of a password managers, but Stripe is in a hard position here because they can't say that it's user's responsibility or password manager's responsibility, because likely this will not protect Stripe users. The result? No going back and forth, no needs more info status, and instead a $2,000 payout as a medium risk bug. The way they fixed it is they removed the autocomplete attribute and they disallow password type input field, so that there is no way that password managers autofill credentials of any Stripe users. Stripe was actually the first program to which I dedicated more time. About 1 year ago, I challenged myself to spend 100 hours there. If you want to see what bugs did I find and how much money I made, check out this two-part video that's on your screen right now. For now, thank you for watching and goodbye.